Welcome to Concavity of a Function. The goal of this video will be to determine the concavity of a function on an interval. F is concave up on an interval if the derivative is increasing over the interval. So for example, if you drew tangent lines at these red points, remember the slope of those tangent lines would be the value of the derivative at those given x values. So the slope here would be negative 4, negative 2, 0, 2, and 4, and you can see that these values are increasing from left to right, therefore the function is concave up. You can see it takes the shape of a cup opening upward. F is concave down on an interval if the derivative is decreasing over the interval. Again, remember the derivative measures the slope of the tangent line. So if we drew a tangent line here, the slope would be 4. Right here it would be 2, here it would be 0, and so on. And if we take a look at these slopes or derivatives at these given x values, they are decreasing in value, therefore it is concave down. You can see a function that's concave down is like an upside down cup. Putting those pieces together, if we look at this graph, we can see in this interval it's concave down. And in this interval over here, it's concave up. Somewhere in the middle here, it changes from being concave down to concave up. That point has a special name. It's called the point of inflection. A point of inflection is a point on the function where the concavity changes from concave up to concave down, or vice versa. If c, f of c is a point of inflection, then either the second derivative is equal to 0 or the second derivative does not exist. Here's an easy way to remember the test for concavity. If the second derivative is positive or greater than 0 on an interval, then the function is concave up on the interval. If the second derivative is negative or less than 0 on the interval, then the function is concave downward. Okay, so let's put all these pieces together. Here's the procedure for determining concavity. Step one, we will determine the values for which the second derivative is equal to zero or undefined. Step two, we'll use these values to determine the test intervals over the function's domain. Then we'll determine the sign of the second derivative. As just stated, if the second derivative is positive, it's concave up on the interval. If it's negative, it's concave down. And last step, if the intervals do change sign, there is a point of inflection. Let's go ahead and give it a try. Determine the open intervals for which the following function is concave up or down. So we have to figure out where the second derivative is equal to zero. We first find the first derivative. Now we find the second derivative. There are no values of x where this is undefined, so we set it equal to 0 and solve. This is factorable. So we have two values where the second derivative is equal to 0. These are where we may have points of inflection. We use these two values to create our intervals. Remember, the original domain is all reals, so we're going to have three intervals to test. Negative infinity to 0, 0 to 2, and 2 to infinity. Now this test should seem very similar to the first derivative test, which tests for increasing and decreasing. But because we're dealing with the second derivative now, we're testing for concavity. So we'll pick our test values. And what we'll do now is type our second derivative into y1 and use our calculator to evaluate the sign of the second derivative. Remember, the second derivative was equal to 12x squared minus 24x. Let's go to our graphing calculator and type that into y1. Go to our table feature. And we're going to test the sign at negative 1, 1, and 3. And we can see first interval is positive, then negative, then positive. Let's go ahead and record this. So what this tells us is the function is concave up on this interval, concave down on this interval, and concave up again on this interval. Since it does change concavity, We do have a point of inflection at 0 and also at x equals 2. So let's go ahead and record this information. We have a point of inflection when x is equal to 0. We still have to go back and find the y-coordinate of that point, and we have another one at x equals 2. We said it's concave up from negative infinity to 0 and from 2 to infinity, and it's concave down from 0 to 2. Okay, so lastly, we have to evaluate the function at x equals 0 and x equals 2. Remember, our original function was f of x is equal to x to the 4th minus 4x to the 3rd. Well, we can easily sub in 0 for x and get 0 for y. Let's go ahead and find f of 2 by hand. Looks like we would have 16 minus 32, which is equal to negative 16. Okay, so let's go ahead and test all of this information that we found by analyzing the graph. First, we found a point of inflection at 0, 0, and 2, negative 16. On this interval, it's concave up. On this interval, it's concave down. And the remaining interval, it's concave up again. This verifies our work. Let's try one more. Determine the open intervals on which the following function is concave up or down. State any points of inflection. Okay, so we have to find the second derivative of this function. So we find the first derivative. Now, by the way, you may think quotient rule, but we can rewrite this as the quantity of x minus 3 raised to the negative 1 power. So we'll go ahead and apply the power rule. So we'd have negative 1 u to the negative 2 power times u prime, but u prime is equal to 1 in this case. So our first derivative simplifies to this. Now we need to find the second derivative. Again, we'll apply the power rule, so we'd have 2 times the quantity x minus 3 raised to the negative 3rd power times u prime, but again, u prime is 1. So our second derivative is equal to 2 divided by the quantity x minus 3 raised to the 3rd power. Now this will never equal 0, but the derivative does not exist when x equals 3. And in fact, x equals 3 is also a point of discontinuity. So we're going to use the value of x equals 3 to determine our test intervals. And you can see here we have negative infinity to 3 and 3 to infinity. Let's use the test values of 2 and 4. And we'll type in our second derivative into y1 again. Remember, our second derivative was 2 divided by x minus 3 to the 3rd power. So we're going to test it at positive 2 and positive 4. We can see the second derivative is negative on this interval and positive on this interval. So we know that it's concave down and concave up on this interval. So it changes concavity at 3, so we have a point of inflection at x equals 3. Again, it's concave up from 3 to infinity, and concave down from negative infinity to 3. We still have to find the y-coordinate of the point of inflection. Remember, the y-coordinate is a point on the function, so we need to evaluate our function at x equals 3. And if we try to do that, we'll see that the function is undefined at that value. So what we've discovered in this case is that even though it does change concavity to x equals 3, since it is a point of discontinuity, we do not have a point of inflection as we first thought. And it's always good to verify this with a graph, so let's go ahead and do that. Here we can see that it is concave down, and here it's concave up, as we found. And we can see why there's not a point of inflection, because we have discontinuity at x equals 3. Okay, I hope that helps explain how you can use the second derivative to determine concavity. Thank you for watching.